Greetings, everyone, and welcome to Progressive Discussions. This happens to be Progressive Discussions number 92. Yes, because we did a belated Progressive Discussions number 91 on Wednesday, which felt very strange. I am your host for Progressive Discussions, James P. Madonna of Megalife 21, the hardest hitting internet talk radio station on the planet. And I am here with my co-host and mentor, the one and only, the Reverend Dr. William J. Eisenman, the founder of Newsletters Censored in 1977. How are you today, sir?
Excellent, excellent.
It happens to be...
A little distressed, but excellent.
Okay, we'll get into that.
That's
it
great.
Happens to be Saturday, November the 5th.
It is.
Am I correct?
All day,
2011. Okay. We're sticklers for being sticklers here at Newsletter Censored. We're sticklers for detail, and we believe there's always room for improvement in every aspect of life. So we give you the date at the beginning of every show. Okay, just for the record. Because the more detail you cover, the less apt some jabroni out there in cyberspace is going to throw something up to your face. But there's always somebody out there, some corporate ass-kissing right-winger that doesn't have a pot to piss in, you know, not even a high income tax bracket, that will always defend the elitists and the Tea Party and corporations and come up with some stupid asinine comment that has no scientific backing or proof whatsoever, and it's bound to happen, you know. But I don't have too much of a theme today, so we're going to get right into the articles. But before we get into the articles, this is my prop. It is an imported Blackthorn Irish Shillelagh, naturally from Ireland. And it is my prop for political reasons, as well as the fact that it helps me emphasize things that need to be emphasized. And it's good for cracking right-wing Republicans over the coconut, over the noggin. And it's a weapons-grade shillelagh, as opposed to the walking stick. And also, it is a very good symbol and very applicable to the Occupy.org movement. Now, the reason why I don't
Occupy
say
Occupy Wall Street.
Well,
.org.
Well, the yeah. Well, now they're occupying just about
everywhere in the country.
Every major city in the United States. So I don't want to keep on saying Wall Street, but in a sense, yes, it is Wall Street because Wall Street is symbolic of the American economy, symbolizing it, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now, before we begin, I would like to announce and salute with the shillelagh. I would like to salute a man who deserves a lot of praise. How can I begin? Mr. Gary Noe, I want to make this the unofficial Gary Noe Appreciation Day here at Newsletter Censored and Megalife 21, because there's no one else that I know of, including certain progressive liberals that used to be on Air America syndicated show, that used to write books and sound brilliant on the radio.
You're talking about Mr. Franken?
Yeah, I'm leading up to Al Frankenstein Franken, the guy who dummied up after he became senator representing the state of Minnesota. What was it? When did they make it official? What year was that?
It's well over a year ago.
Yeah, oh, well over a year ago.
I believe it was 2008.
Al Franken dummies up. Nobody hears from him. And then I was informed that he voted to extend the Bush tax cuts for the rich. Hey, not so progressive and liberal, Al Franken. But what I'm saying is, Mr. Gary Noe, is, aside from being a brilliant man and a very compassionate man and hardworking man defending the little guy and you know, the poor and the sick and contributing more to the overall health of humanity, of Americans, than any other one person, because he's well known as a health, fitness, and nutrition guru, okay, second to none. He helps a lot of people. If you're poor and destitute, Reverend Bill, is it true that sometimes he treats people for free, pro bono?
I believe he treats people for free all the time.
If you're poor and you
in
can
fact,
prove
he
it,
pays,
and you can prove it, huh?
In fact, he pays. I think he's got three on his staff now, psychologists. If you have to go to them,
oh, really,
he pays them. You do not.
Are they one of those natural, orthomolecular psychologists?
Psychologists.
Okay, but he has a staff.
He has a big staff, yes.
And I don't know if he still calls his establishment the Tri-State Healing Center or something
yes,
like
he,
that.
Yes, he does. Yes.
And his stores in Manhattan are called the Vitamin Closet, right?
Vitamin Closet.
He owns all the Vitamin Closets, or just
two of them.
Are they franchised?
Two. No, he owns them.
He owns it, lock, stock, and barrel. Okay. He
owns lock, stock, and bulk.
Right. He owns the Vitamin Closet, and from what I see with the Vitamin Shop turning a very corporatist and very bottom-line oriented, pushing their products with their label on it, even though the brand name products are superior, they keep on pushing high-pressure sales, pushing for that profit. Like a restaurant pushing drinks on you instead of food, because they know they make more money off of drinks, which is a big scam also. But because of that, I wish that Gary Knowles' Vitamin Closet is very successful, and that it grows, and that it pounds the Vitamin Shop into the ground. Because I have certain negative feelings towards that company, and that's exactly what they do. Super high pressure sales, pushing their product, even though it's in a lot of ways inferior to the brand name products, because they make a much higher profit off of their products. As simple as that. But they tell you their products is better than the brand name. They lie. It's snake oil salesmanship. You know, it seems like in America, everything that is for sale in the capitalist system we have here is saturated with exaggerations and lies and misrepresentations and deception. And of course,
are you talking about Republicans? Because
yeah,
that's how they get elected.
Yeah, well, of course, right-wing conservative Republicans love a deregulation of business and the fact that they can lie to you, and this consumer does not have any rights at all. So this is what's going on. So I wish the Gary Knoll Vitamin Closet well, and as well as the fact that Gary Knoll has been showing up at the Occupy Wall Street protesting, right, to speak.
I think he's been there like 22 times, 21 times, something
well,
like that.
Well, that means Gary Knoll is very much politically involved.
And he had that video, which is on Facebook.
The video of him,
where he interviews people.
Where he interviews people. Yeah. And so Gary Knoll is not just a premier health and nutrition guru. He is also one of the heavy hitters in the progressive movement. And I have him on my Facebook friends list, and I believe so does the Reverend Dr. William J. Eisenman.
Yeah.
Now, salute.
Salute.
To Mr. Gary Knoll. Doctor, he has a PhD now?
Two of them.
Dr. Gary Knoll, we salute you here at Megalife 21 and Newsletter Censored, and I believe that Gary Knoll knows the Reverend Dr. William J. Eisenman. He receives the Newsletter Censored, and he has spoken to the Reverend Dr. William J. Eisenman on the phone, how many times? Once?
I believe it was a couple of times, way back in, remember Waco?
The Wacko from Waco?
Waco,
David,
yeah,
David
yeah.
Koresh?
That was the early 90s or something?
Right.
he thought I had some, I wrote an article about it.
Right.
And he wanted some more information because he was doing something on it.
Okay.
So.
All right. Salute to Dr. Gary Noh. I do not know where the little guy would be without Gary Noh. So thank God for Gary Noh, and we thank you, Gary Noh, for being there and doing all the things that you do, all the positive things. And we appreciate Dr. Gary Noh. Salute.
Salute.
To Shillelagh. Without hitting myself in the head as I come back. Anyway, let's get to the first article, because I can go on and on and on about this deregulation of corporate companies and this whole conservative Republican crap that pisses me off to no end.
All right, remember we did discuss the fish, the mysterious fish that had both male and female sex characteristics last time.
Asexual fish.
Okay.
Like a snail, asexual.
And we did not finish up, so I will just read the last two paragraphs.
Do you know where you left off? Because we got cut off Wednesday because we were behind 2 weeks and we ran out of power, and I did not, the camera person did not have the camera, the video camera plugged in to an electrical outlet, and this is what happens because the battery can only go so long. So it kind of went out. I was saying something, let me see, I was saying something to the effect, I was talking about elitists not caring, and of course I was talking about Chris Christie, and then I...
Funny you should mention Chris Christie, because there was an article in the paper today, a lead article, that said that food pantries are suffering in New Jersey.
Yeah, but not Chris Christie's food pantry.
Well, then maybe that's why, because he's taking all the food.
I'm sure Chris Christie, if he wanted to, can eat rock lobster tail and filet mignon like every day.
Or Dungeness crab.
Dungeness crab. He belongs in a dungeon. Ozzie Bucco's dungeon. He should be tortured. But anyway, what I was saying before I got cut off, before we lost power, was that the right-wing conservative fat cat elitists hate immigrants of color, particularly, it seems that way, particularly Latinos from south of the border. They despise immigrants of color and want to ship them out of the country, and they want to racially profile and practice racism, except when the illegal immigrants of color are cleaning their pools, cleaning their homes, cooking their food, and landscaping their mansions, manicuring their mansions, and becoming nannies for their little spoiled brat silver spoon children, overly coddled, spoiled little brats. Then illegal immigrants of color are fine. Then, you know, then they like Latinas and everything, you know, because they get to pay them probably less than minimum wage with no benefits. So there's no problem in the Southern Bible Belt red states with illegal immigrants from Mexico if the Mexicans are working very cheap for them, since the right-wing fat cats are so stingy and greedy. That's where I left off, or what I was about to tell you people before the power got cut. Now I got to say it. Another thing I forgot to say is when we were talking about professional wrestling industry and what happened to us recently with an indie circuit promotion, is that another thing that besides wrestlers not really being professional wrestlers, since when they graduate from wrestling school, after paying $3,000, they don't get paid, they get stiffed. There is no health insurance for these very same quote-unquote professional wrestlers, these kids coming out of wrestling school. If they get hurt, they have to pay out of pocket and supply their own health insurance. So I forgot to mention that too. But anyway, now I'm up to date. First article.
All right, so we're dealing with the intersex fish. Okay?
Sex porn. I mean, fish porn.
Fish porn.
Fish porn.
Lab studies are underway to isolate the potential causes.
Yeah.
But the solution to the mystery could be years away.
Okay.
And Edward F. Orlando, a reproductive biologist at the University of Maryland, says that while there is cause for concern, there's no cause for panic.
That must be a fun job in his clinic. What is he, like Masters and Johnson?
Intersex fish affect the ecosystems we depend on. But we don't know enough to say that the water we are drinking or the fish we are eating pose a cause for concern. Environmentalists are skeptical. The intersex fish are like the canary in the coal mine, says Catherine Baer of the national nonprofit group American Rivers. We see what's happening to the fish, and the water they're swimming in is the water we are drinking.
You mean before it's supposedly filtered properly by reverse osmosis, I'm assuming?
Yeah.
No,
what is harming the fish is in the water.
Well, that's another talk show that I discussed on Health Talk, is the what is found in our typical municipal drinking water here in America, tap water, and it's not a pretty sight. And if you don't have a good filtration system at home, like at least a Brita, or better yet, reverse osmosis, you're in trouble. I mean, there's all kinds of nasty things. There was a cryptosporidium.
Not only nasty
and parasites,
but they have to filter out poo-poo.
They have to filter out everything that shouldn't be there. I mean...
Because that's where it gets dumped.
There was a product from Canada, a company. I'm sure there might be others, but this was years ago. It was called Quench. And I'm sure there are other companies too. But it was a water cooler that you hooked up to your plumbing in your own home, and it had a reverse osmosis filtration system, which I thought was cool, because as you used the filtered purified water in your in the dispenser of the water cooler, the reverse osmosis would automatically kick in and continue to refill that dispenser. You know, with reverse osmosis filtrated purified water from your tap. So it was continuous because it was hooked up to the plumbing. You didn't have to carry gallons of spring water from the supermarket, or, you know, you didn't have to refill the Brita. Mm-hmm. So, you know, but anyway.
St. Paul, Minnesota.
Okay.
A federal judge has dismissed a lawsuit,
Jesse,
by former Minnesota Governor Jesse Ventura.
I'm glad you mentioned it, because I read an article online yesterday about him, Jesse Ventura, being very irate about losing, about having it thrown out, and it had to do with the Department of Homeland Security's groping.
Groping in the x-rays.
At international airports? Mm-hmm. The groping that's going on? Okay, continue.
He sought to challenge the use of full body scans and pat-downs at airport checkpoints. Ventura sued the Department of Homeland Security and the Transportation Security Administration in January, alleging that the scans and pat-downs violated his right to be free from unreasonable searches and seizure. U.S. District Court Judge Susan Richard Nelson ruled Thursday that the court lacked jurisdiction.
Oh, really? And that's when Jesse Ventura said that we live in the fascist states of America?
Well, of course we did, under Bush. Habeas corpus went out the window, the Fourth Amendment out the window, the Sixth Amendment out the window, under the Patriot Act.
Interesting.
So it's not fascist, because fascist, you know, is corporations married to the government. Mm-hmm. It's totalitarian. Okay? Just like Russia was, and, you know, the Soviet Union, and China, and all these other, Korea. They're dictators. They're totalitarians.
So, because of, during the Bush administration, because of 9/11, post 9/11,
right,
the whole immigration system and everything was converted to the Department of Homeland Security,
yeah.
And under a conservative Washington, everybody is, I assume, guilty until proven innocent.
Correct.
And they implement racial profiling.
Correct.
They profile.
Correct.
Because Republicans, deep down, really,
and they violate your right to freedom.
They really are racist, and they really don't like the little guy, and they despise the poor, and they're greedy, and they're stingy.
The little guy is a herd animal to be controlled.
You mean like fodder?
That's correct.
Or not fodder, livestock. And well, they want to enslave the poor. Like that bullshit, what were you telling me? They're trying to bring back debtors' prisons?
That too, yeah. I believe they're back in some areas.
You know why I think they want to do it? As an excuse for legalized slave labor. Just get this.
Yes, you see that one
people,
place.
Let me finish. People are in debt. Poor people are in debt. Under a Republican, they go, oh, you can't file, what is it, Chapter 11, personal bankruptcy? We're gonna stick you in debtor's prison. Then they turn around and they make you work for like maybe 50 cents an hour or a dollar an hour or maybe free.
None. They want the what's that place there that's got the prisoners being firemen? They're fighting fires.
Right, where, with their urine? They're pissing on the fire?
I don't know what they're doing, but...
So, an excuse for slave labor, just like the other scam of interns from school, hiring interns, well, you're not hiring them, interns from school getting school credit or college credit, are getting paid nothing from the company that they work for. And what happens is when those interns graduate and hopefully get jobs, well, there's really no jobs out there, then they get new, fresh interns from the school, and they have a perpetual constant flow of free labor. You know, the people that work in employment agencies and the people that work in corporate say, oh, it's not slavery, it's an internship, they're getting experience for their resume, but you're still making people get their asses out of bed in the morning and putting in 20 or 30 hours a week working for free. They have to commute, they have to burn expensive gasoline, wear and tear on their car, oil, so on and so on and so on and so on and so on. It's free labor. Free labor. What does that mean? You work for free. It's slavery.
If it looks like a duck and walks like a duck and quacks like a duck, it's a duck.
It's a duck. No matter how you shake it, it's a duck. And I'm not talking about that stupid asshole duck song that has millions of hits on YouTube. And I can't believe people make a big fuss over it. What is it? Like the women love that thing?
I don't know.
So stupid. And instead of looking at...
And there's several versions of it, too.
Instead of looking and viewing videos where you could learn something, where you could find out what's really going on, what's going on with your country and the world, education, they look at the duck song. Anyway,
by the way, I had to register the other day at YouTube.
Why?
To see that video.
What video?
Judge beats daughter with belt.
Oh, because they want to make sure you're over 18?
Yeah.
But it's not porno.
Yeah, and violence is fine. The Supreme Court said that it's all right for kids to look at violence.
Well, when Vinnie Blake was in the dungeon with his sex swing, there are other videos about sex swings and adult nature, and you have to sign in to verify that you're over 18 to view the videos.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not porn. You know what's funny?
Yeah. And I noticed that Google owns YouTube.
Yes, Google, it's a merger. They didn't, no, what happened was they, it's complicated. Esmeralda explained to me, they merged. It's not that Google bought out YouTube. She says it, they merged. Now, I'm going to guess and say Google's a bigger company.
Yeah.
So maybe down the road they'll own it outright. But you know what's funny? Well, we're talking, I'm, as far as women being topless in public or on video, on TV, or let's just say YouTube. If it's something like National Geographic with native people that are topless normally, or if it has to do with the subject of manual breast exams, or lactating women feeding their babies, they show bare breasts. They're right out there. Big ones, too.
Mm.
Nipples, the whole nine yards. Hard nipples, no problem showing it. But if it has to do with breasts, shown for the sole purpose of arousing men, it's not permitted. But it's still bare
prurient
breasts.
Prurient interest.
It's still bare breasts.
Prurient interest.
Interesting. Yeah. Double standards in our society.
Yeah.
Interesting. All right, continue.
The National Restaurant Association confirmed on Friday that it had paid a financial settlement to a woman who complained of sexual harassment by Herman Cain.
Gotta prove it.
And the woman's lawyer issued a statement saying the complaint involved several instances of inappropriate behaviors and unwanted advances.
I gotta prove it.
The attorney, Joel Bennett, said the allegations in 1999 involved multiple instances over a period of time, at least a month or two. He did not identify his client, one of two women reported to receive monetary settlements involving allegations against Cain during his three-year tenure as leader of the trade group. As an aside,
that's what a lot of women do, attractive women do with famous.
But if you're not guilty, you do not settle.
That's what a lot of very attractive women do, that when they date a very famous and rich sports figure, an athlete, they look at that athlete as the goose that laid the golden egg, and they try to scam them, dupe them out of money using the sexual harassment trend here. I mean, being that the courts happen to favor women.
I don't think the Supreme Court does.
Including chasing a guy down for, a paternity suit for, child support payments and everything. Meanwhile, it takes two to do the tango. It takes two to do the tango unless it's forced rape. Otherwise, the woman is just as guilty as of the encounter if there's an encounter. If there's no encounter and they're proven unwanted advancements, and with touching and words and, harassment, that's got to be proven.
His client, currently a federal employee, was married at the time and remains so today. The lawyer said he declined to provide additional specifics, saying his client felt it would be extremely painful to do so. The Restaurant Association, in its statement, said Mr. Herman Cain disputed the allegations at the time and the settlement was made without any admission of liability. Excuse me. Mm. The statements marked the latest chapter in the sexual harassment controversy that has roiled the Cain campaign this week. Since Sunday night, when Politico first reported the allegations against Cain, the candidate has offered a series of conflicting accounts. He first said he did not know whether any settlements had been paid and did not recall specifics of any allegations. Then he said his recollection was improving and offered his own version, which cast his behavior as innocent. On Wednesday, he said he had told the entire story in detail in 2003 to a former aide who now works for Texas Governor Rick Perry.
Oh, gee.
And he accused the Perry campaign of having leaked the story, something Perry's aides have denied. But little has been heard from those who filed the complaints, whose settlements included a non-disclosure clause. Bennett's client, you know, that's what happens with all the pharmaceuticals who damage or kill people. They always make the client sign a disclosure agreement.
The waiver?
A gag! A gag order! You can't tell the truth! Or we'll take the money back.
How
what kind
get,
of a
how
situation?
How do they get away with that shit?
Well, they do it.
The truth should always be told.
Oh.
The truth shall set you free, brother.
Yeah, but if we can't get at it, and we don't have the megaphone, what then?
So.
And if the Koch brothers, you know, have all their money to work against us, so then what do you do?
So he who has the most gold rules, is that what you're trying to say?
Yeah.
Corruption?
Yeah.
Is abound?
That's what we have now.
He who makes haste to be rich shall not be innocent?
That's true.
Is that Proverbs?
What about he who oppresses the poor to increase his riches?
And he who
we have that going on every day.
And he who gives to the rich shall surely come to want. That's Proverbs also.
What is it if not oppressing the poor when you, as a rich person, do not want to pay your fair share of taxes and put it on their backs? What is that?
Yeah, you know what? You know what I'm getting sick of? I'm getting sick of a weeper of the house, John Bonehead Boner Bain, or whatever you want to call him, talking about taxing the rich is a job killer. What a bunch of bullshit. Taxing the rich puts money back in the pocket of the little guy to spend into the economy, and preventing the outsourcing would bring back the job market here. Cutting taxes from the rich does not create jobs in the United States. And he keeps on. They're like robots that repeat the same thing over and over again.
Because that's all they have.
Job killing. Job
that's
killing.
All they have.
You tax the rich, you will kill job. You will kill job. You will kill. Because they're a bunch of whores. They're a bunch of corporate whores that are on the take.
They have this. But to reaffirm, in God we trust, on the mullah. This is what they do in Congress.
Well, I tell you one thing, John.
So what is job, 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 job?
Yeah, job, job, job.
If you're going to do this crap.
Snow job is
That's
more like
it.
It's a snow job.
Yeah.
John Boehner is an outstanding actor. Snake oil salesman, because when he cries, those are crocodile tears. But it's amazing how he, what does he do? He has a raw onion wrapped up under his desk, and he turns around and he rubs the onion on his nose and eyes, and then he does that. He does it better than Bill Clinton did, you know, with I feel your pain, the tear.
Yeah.
Yeah, John Boehner's got the whole waterworks going. I bet he's got a raw onion put away somewheres.
Anyway, this lawyer's client sought release from that provision after Kane dismissed the sexual harassment complaints as untrue. So, you see, the woman who's made that settlement, she wants to tell the truth, but mm-hmm. she can't. She can't. Kane has generally said these complaints were baseless, that he did not engage mm-hmm. in sexual harassment. My client, the lawyer said, felt that she wanted to respond to those statements in a prudent way. The Restaurant Association's current chief executive, Don Sweeney, said the group is willing to waive the confidentiality requirements should the woman desire to speak about the complaint. But the lawyer said additional comment is unlikely because his client felt there's no value of revisiting the matter now or discussing it further publicly or privately. Across town, Kane spoke to a Washington convention of conservative activists, giving no indication that he was distressed by the allegations. So far, there has been no indication the allegations have harmed his campaign, which claims donations have risen this week. And that's usually typical with Republicans. In fact, he went to another, might have been the same meeting, and he said in the meeting, I mean, this is how flippant they are, I'm one of the Koch brothers' children by another mother.
Oh, really? A brother?
They're proud of this, taking money from the Koch brothers to do their dirty deeds to harm the poor and unions and teachers and firemen and policemen, etc., etc. They're proud of it.
And these are the Herman Cain people?
Not the Herman Cain people.
I'm sorry.
Republicans.
Republicans,
period.
In general, period.
Yeah, conservatives.
But has, does Herman Cain like the Koch brothers?
He said it. He said he's one of their children by another mother.
A brother from another mother. So he turned his back on low income African American.
He's never been for them.
African American population, his own people. He turned his back on them.
No, blacks are all brainwashed.
Brainwashed. Okay, I'm glad you brought this up. You finished with that article, right?
Yeah.
Hold your horses. Brainwashed to believe what? That there's opportunity in America for African Americans of low income, that there's jobs out there. That
you said, if you don't have a job and you're not rich, blame yourself.
Okay, blame yourself. So what if you're not as well connected and talented to magically become a huge success, a self-made millionaire or a self-made middle class? What if you're stuck in the ghetto because there's no opportunity, or you don't have the super dynamic talents, and you don't have a college scholarship? It's your fault.
Yes.
What about just fate, circumstance, that you happen to be poor?
Well, that's your fault.
Or that you don't
pick yourself up by the bootstraps,
or the poor
man.
Kid, bootstraps?
Yeah.
You should pick yourself up. You should pick himself.
Look, he did. He's a great example.
Oh, really? He's not a silver spooner. He's self-made, right?
Yeah, self-made man.
And did he grow up with a father?
Grandfather's pizza.
Did he grow up with a male role model, father figure?
I don't know.
Really?
Too much about his childhood floating around.
Now, I'm glad you brought that up. Now, what percentage of people in the capitalist system since the beginning of American capitalism ever increased their standard of living? You told me the figures one
10%.
Time. 10%. So what you're saying is,
over this 200 and some years,
after 200 some odd years, only 10% of the American population ever increased their standard of living.
And move up.
Not necessarily just rags to riches, but move up. Just like, you know, maybe from lower middle class to middle class, or from poor to lower middle class, only 10%, which means you got to be lucky there, my friends. There's definitely luck involved, you know, and connections, like Silver Spoon kids, you know, with their daddy's friends, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Donald Trump's father, real estate tycoon to begin with. We got to take a break. We'll be back. Hello there. We're back. Right now, my co-host and mentor, the Reverend Dr. William J. Eisenman, is partaking in his gastronomic delight known as lunch, followed by high green tea. And this is the time I usually do promo. Now, I'm not sure if you are going to mention the name of Michelle Bubblehead Bachman or Sarah Nalen Palin.
Not that I
or
know of.
Christine the Witch, the Slutty Witch O'Donnell. I call them, well, there are others in Republican Party that are women. The Conservative Coven of Witches. But when they talk, this is all I hear. It's a little satire on the Conservative Coven of Witches. In this case, let's focus on Michelle Bubblehead Bachman, because we haven't really heard from Sarah Nalen Palin in a long time, right?
Yeah.
I think she's got some guy on his side, some dude, right? She's banging somebody on his side. Is that what's going on?
I don't know.
That's what I heard through the grapevine. This is what I hear when they talk, because they're idiots. They're political morons. They're nothing but human slide whistles. They don't make sense. So that's all I hear. Anyway, promo. This gentleman right next to me is a self-portrait of my co-host and mentor and founder of Newsletter Censored in 1977, the Reverend Dr. William J. Eisenman. The Reverend Dr. William J. Eisenman is a fine watercolor artist, and this self-portrait is a fine watercolor painting of himself. That's why I call it a self-portrait. Duh. The William J. Eisenman collection can be seen on the internet via YouTube, okay, or it can be seen on the William J. Eisenman Facebook profile, and I hope his album is visible to the public, because you know what? That big nose, eagle beak prick punk Mark Zuckerberg, the creator of Facebook, his website has a lot of glitches. So I don't know if the album is visible to the public, to the pubic public. And you can go to newslettercensored.com to view also. And I don't know about all of his paintings.
Some of them,
okay. Anyway.
I don't have enough space for all of them.
Right. If you like any of the fine watercolor paintings by the Reverend Dr. William J. Eisenman, you can send him an email asking him if that particular one is available, and if it is, the bidding starts at $500 each. You will receive an authentic, one-of-a-kind, freshly made, well, that's if it's freshly made, signed by William J. Eisenman, watercolor painting. It's not a print. It is an authentic watercolor painting that will be sent to you by William J. Eisenman, the founder of Newsletter Censored and my co-host and mentor. Okay? And it will have his signature on it. So it's much better than just having him sign an 8x10 black and white glossy picture of himself. But if that's what you want, you can ask him. You know, if there's a demand for it, we might make these, signed autographs, 8x10s available if enough people want them, you know, for $10 each, you know, and just give us your name and, of course, your address, and make sure you give it to us, clearly, so we understand where the hell you live. And we'll send you an autograph 8x10. Now for the backbone of our organization. Newsletter Censored, founded in 1977 by the Reverend Dr. William J. Eisenman. This newsletter is one of a kind. It contains information that most people are afraid to hear. Can you handle it? It contains the five taboos of American life, which is politics, religion, health care, child rearing. Did I leave anything out?
Sex.
Sex, there we go. Human sexuality. Gee, I wonder why I left that out.
It wasn't 17 seconds. Every 17 seconds, men think of sex.
Oh, I need 17 seconds, right? Okay. Anyway. There is more information in the newsletter than there is on our talk shows or on our websites. So the best way to be a part of our organization, the best way to join our organization, is to get your free annual subscription to Newsletter Censored with your gift to support this work. Go to newslettercensored.com, read all of the hard-hitting information on that website. Don't forget to check out Dr. Bill for President, where he teaches you that you can write in your candidate. The candidate, by law, does not have to be on the ballot in that voting booth. You know,
where it costs you money to do so.
Yeah.
By the Democratic Party and the Republican Party.
And your independent candidate might never be seen on any presidential debates to fairly give that person a chance to explain his or her platform and what they're about and their opinion, you know, which is only fair. But, you know, the fat cats want to suppress people that want to do good and solve problems. Because solving problems means making the fat cats pay their fair share in taxes and taking the burden off of the middle class and the poor, you know, which goes contrary to their greed. Anyway, this is it. There's a printable order form at newslettercensored.com, and with your gift to support this work, get your free annual subscription right now to Newsletter Censored. And for those of you that just jumped on board our show now, there is something called Censored On Demand, Archive Classics, and there is The God Project also on demand by the Reverend Dr. William J. Eisenman, and you can go online, you can Google it, actually. You don't even have to go to YouTube, it'll come up. And there are two playlists that contain almost every past reading that was ever done on video and audio on demand. So you can click it as many times as you want and you can listen to them as many times as you want. If you have insomnia and your brain is awake late at night and you can't sleep, listen to some Censored On Demands or God Projects. You know, God Project is on the Pirate Radio Network every Sunday anyway, you know, from our Megalife 21 hard-hitting internet talk radio station. And from 2 to 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. But many God Projects are available. All the past ones are available on demand, which is great. You get to click it. You get to stop it, you know, pause it. If you're interrupted, you could resume listening to it. It's a wonderful thing, you know. There's something on YouTube about how to make money off of your videos in 4 easy steps. It's called monetization, something like that. I gotta check out the details of what that is. And I'm not sure what it is, but we have almost 900 videos in the Megalife 21 arsenal.
It all boils down to advertising.
Oh, you and your old-fashioned spending money on advertising.
Well, that's how you get the people.
Well, maybe this monetization thingy from that YouTube is that's offering people. Maybe this is a new high-tech 2020.
They're going to offer you
21st century way to promote your agenda at a very minimal cost. I don't know.
Minimal cost.
Well, let's put it this way. The codes that programmers use to get your website on the front page of Google, they definitely work, and they don't cost you a dime.
Yeah, but they wanted to.
Unless you have to pay somebody to tweak and edit your web page. But if you have the knowledge, you do it yourself, huh?
The corporations wanted...
Fuck the corporations.
...that they only could go onto the first page when they paid moolah.
Fuck them.
Okay?
Well, guess what? We're on the front page of Google, and we're not paying anybody a fee. Fees are for suckers. screw them. There's more than one way to skin an eel. I would say cat, but I like cats. I think they're adorable. Eels. I'm not too crazy. You know, eels are very high in omega-3 fatty acids, even much higher than salmon. You know, it's very high too. I know Carlton Fredericks, when he was alive, used to say, if you eat either the Alaskan salmon, or I think he mentioned, I'm not sure if he mentioned the Pacific sardine, which happens to be the highest concentrated source, but if you eat the fish out of the can, just 2 or 3 ounces, you get more omega-3 than the supplement.
Yeah.
Like Pacific sardines, I think 2 ounces of Pacific Ocean sardines give you a huge whopping dose of omega-3 fatty acids, which is very medicinal for the human body.
I used to eat Norwegian sardinias.
Yeah, I like the flavor. Oh, the bristlings? King Oscar?
Not the bristlings, smaller ones.
King Oscar.
I don't like...
Those are bristlings.
Well,
they're tiny, right?
They were like that.
Excuse me.
Those kind. I like the thin, small ones.
Yeah, these are the ones you're talking about. I used to get when they were on... Excuse me, folks. I used to get them when they were on sale. It said, packed in sardine sealed oil. In other words, you know how they're either packed in soybean oil or olive oil, but this was packed in sardine, in fish oil itself. So it was had a whopping amount, and they were tiny, and they were from Norway.
Yeah.
And sometimes they were put out by a company called King Oscar, who I assume is Norwegian. Maybe he doesn't exist. You know, like the...
What was that other one?
Like
Clyde's, the Quaker Oats guy, old man, huh? Clyde's.
Oh, Port Clyde.
Port Clyde.
That's out of Maine. It's out of Maine, but they're also in New Brunswick, Maritime Province, Canada. But they usually pack them in spring water or
mustard,
or which I love, mustard sauce. Anyway, you're talking about the little tiny sliver is the little they look like tiny anchovies.
Yeah.
Bristlings. But anyway, getting back to what I'm trying to say is the Pacific sardines are much higher in omega-3s than just about anything except eel. The only thing is eels have to be from a reliable source, because eels are bottom feeding scavengers that often can contain toxins, you know, like crab. You know, when you eat steamed crabs, they call it the mustard of the crab. Well, that's actually the bile of the crab or the lobster. You don't want to eat that from a bottom feeding scavenger animal, because that is where all the toxins will be concentrated.
Or like eating liver today.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Well, liver from a source that's not too good.
Well,
you know what I mean? I mean, of course, if it's...
It's going to still contain whatever, because it is the liver, and that's its job, is to detox.
Yeah, if it's Argentine, you know, grass-fed, organic Argentine beef, of course the liver is going to be great. It's going to be pure. But I don't like liver. You would have to marinate liver heavily in some kind of a masala, an Indian masala or curry seasoning with sea salt, garlic powder, for me to even touch beef liver, because
I like liver.
I really don't like it.
I like liver.
But it has to be seasoned and marinated properly.
I like liver, but I don't eat it anymore because of that reason.
Liver makes me quiver. Anyway, ha-ha. Speaking of ha-ha-ha, my message to the Herman Cain campaign entourage, his people, is why don't you call him Herman Hurricane Cain?
Cool.
Being that when he opens his mouth, being that he's a right-wing Republican, you know, he's got a lot of things to say, and he's not too shy about saying it. You know, when he opens his mouth, it's like getting hit with a hurricane. So, Herman Hurricane Cain. There you go. That's my gift to you. That's the only gift that I will give to a right-wing Republican this year and next year. Hurricane Kane. You can have that for free. Get back to the articles.
Regarding former Governor Christine Todd Whitman's Wall Street demonstrators' misdirect anger.
Hold on. A Republican female? That's because they...
One of the governors who got our state into the problems that is today.
You mean a Christine Todd Whitless?
Yeah. Yeah.
Or Titless?
The air is okay down there.
Huh?
That's what she said. 911.
And
the air is okay down there.
The air is okay down there. And did you know that Christine Todd Whitman had illegal immigrants cleaning her house?
Yeah, she did.
Cleaning her house? Illegal immigrants that were paid... Peanuts, probably, or chicken scratch.
And she gave out a 30% tax gift to the rich in our state, which caused the pension funds to pay for it, and the poor and the middle class.
Is she the one that first started jacking up the property taxes on New Jersey homeowners? Was she the one that initiated, or was it Tom Kane?
I don't know. I don't know how long Jersey has had the property tax.
Yeah, Tom Kane's a Republican also. He was a Republican. He's the one that used to say New Jersey and you perfect together.
No, perfect.
Perfect. With Herman Brooks Shields used to do that commercial.
Yeah.
The one with the bitch, overbearing bitch of a stage mother, Brooks Shields. Yeah. All right, continue.
I have noticed that she is enamored of the word simplistic. That Wall Street single-handedly caused the financial crisis is overly simplistic. The ideas espoused by the protesters are simplistic. I like this word myself. In fact, I find her arguments extremely simplistic.
I'm not urinating, people. I'm pouring my tea.
And utterly inaccurate.
Yeah.
In her politically motivated defense of the rich... The good governor ignores that according to the 2010 census, the top earning 20% of Americans received 49.4% of all income generated in the United States, compared with the 3.4% made by the bottom 20% of earners. Also, she conveniently forgot that the credit default swaps, the financial instruments that contributed to the ruin of our economy, were invented by Wall Street in 1990, and the market for them ballooned from $900 billion in 2000 to more than $30 trillion in 2008. Maybe the former governor should read How Markets Fail, The Logic of Economic Calamities, by New Yorker writer John Cassidy. I'm sure she will have a more informed understanding of why people are upset.
Interesting.
Another gentleman on the same subject.
Uh-huh.
Christine Todd Whitman, a former Republican governor, has some advice for what's ailing the Wall Street demonstrators. Vote. If only it were that simple. The United States Supreme Court, a majority of whose justices were appointed by Republican presidents, ruled that corporations are now people. They are free to give as much money as they want to candidates of their choice, anonymously. I suppose cynics would say the rich can buy all the politicians they want. The Republicans in state legislatures have also been busy, knowing that the poor, the elderly, and minorities tend to vote for Democrats. Republicans have passed regulations demanding photo IDs for voting. Rules designed to make it more difficult and in some cases impossible for these people to vote. No one is saying the rich are evil. What people are coming to grips with is the old adage about money and power. Mm-hmm. Power corrupts, and absolute power corrupts absolutely. When the rich pass laws that favor only the rich at everyone else's expense, you end up with a nation where 400 individuals have more wealth than 150 million households.
Wow.
Where 46 million Americans are on food stamps. Where unions, Social Security, Medicare, social programs, and the environment are under attack. And where Wall Street deregulation crashes the world economy. Whitman says, vote. Occupy Wall Street says, the system is rigged. We are poor and powerless. We can only stand in the snow and protest while the rich pundits cry class warfare.
You know, excellent article. Could you please tell me the name of the gentleman?
The gentleman was Johnny Najarian.
John
Johnny.
Johnny? John A or Johnny?
Johnny. Johnny. Johnny.
Johnny Najarian.
J-O-A-H-H-N-N-I-E. Johnny.
Johnny Najarian. Great. Fantastic article. Oh, by the way, the new South Park episode this week is a satire of the Occupy Wall Street protesting, and it was quite funny. And they mentioned class warfare and things like that, you know, and rightfully so, you know, the Republicans are always screaming, "Oh, class warfare." You know what? It is warfare.
But it's never class warfare when it's done against the poor and the middle class, is it?
No, it's okay.
Only when it's done against the rich, wanting the rich to pay their fair share.
Yeah.
Then it's class warfare.
Yeah, when it comes to starving out the poor and closing the social programs.
Or throwing them out of their homes.
Foreclosing on their mortgages and making them homeless and throwing them out of their homes. Yeah. And closing the food pantries and taking away their food stamps and their welfare and their Medicaid and this and that and blah, blah. And trying to sabotage Medicare and Social Security.
Yeah.
Right-wingers. Then it's not class warfare. It seems to be one-sided with these people, isn't it? They don't like to play fair, do they?
They don't play fair. They own the narrative. They make their statements, and then they make sure through propaganda that their statements are accepted rather than truth.
And conservative propaganda is what you hear during a campaign from Republicans, period.
Actually, you hear a lot of conservative propaganda from Democrats also.
You mean sellouts?
Sure.
Traitorous.
Corporatists.
Senators Dodd and Baucus and Lieberman. Well, Lieberman is like independent, but he's a jerk. Anyway. And Al Franken is another jerk. Another sellout. Otherwise, he would be shooting his mouth off like he did when he was on Air America, when he had the syndicated radio show, and writing all kinds of books. He would be still heard.
All of a sudden, he's,
And then he votes to extend...
Shut the mouth.
He votes to extend the Bush tax cuts on the rich. Al Franken, Senator Al... Since he's Senator Al Franken. Al Franken,
Yep.
He came from show business originally, right? A writer for Saturday Night Live.
Yep.
No wonder he had a price. Fucking sleazy entertainment industry, motherfucker. Go ahead.
In a twist, on his 2008 campaign slogan, President Obama suggested that Republicans are adopting a no-we-can't approach to the jobs crisis, blocking steps to boost the economy to deal him a political setback. Obama spoke at a high school Tuesday on the second day of his bus tour through North Carolina and Virginia, a campaign-style trip in which he is trying to pressure Congress to pass his jobs package. He's also trying to rebuild his standing in the two battleground states. The president warned that opponents of his $447 billion jobs bill risk a public backlash if they reject proposals that would stave off teacher layoffs and boost hiring to fix aging public infrastructure. Those lawmakers will need to explain their votes to angry constituents. Obama rallied voters during his first run for the White House with an affirming message, "Yes, we can." Recalling those headier times, he urged people to phone, write, and tweet their support for his jobs plan. "I need your voices heard," he said. "I need you to give Congress a piece of your mind. Tell these members of Congress they're supposed to be working for you."
Okay.
He continued, "Remind them that no, we can't. It's not a good motto." Republicans have dismissed the bus tour, and are showing no appetite for Obama's proposed American Jobs Act, a piece of which may be voted on by the Senate this week.
We're up against the forces of evil here, my friends. We're up against the forces of evil. I was talking to the Renaissance man, Ken Create, who happens to be performing today in West Milford, New Jersey, for an organization called Concert for the Caring. It's a fundraiser, and he's performing. I was talking to him about how when you're dealing with people who you think are on the same page as you, when you're dealing with organizations that are on your side and you figure nothing can go wrong, all of a sudden something mysteriously sabotages the plan, like something throws a monkey wrench into it, that this could be the forces of evil trying to sabotage the small flock, God's church, trying to do something positive.
Of course.
Mysteriously, monkey wrenches get thrown in.
Mm-hmm.
And you know that well, just as well as Ken, probably even longer. You know that, so you never know. Could be Satan. All right, Chief, what do we got?
Just as that Energy Star tag helps consumers choose appliances, a new report says a rating symbol on the front of every soup can, cereal box, and yogurt container could help hurried shoppers go home with the healthiest foods. Thursday's report urges the Food and Drug Administration to adopt new food labeling to clear the confusing clutter off today's packages and give consumers a fast way to compare choices. It wouldn't replace the in-depth nutrition facts panel that's now on the back or side of food packages. But few shoppers stop to read or heed that fine print in the middle of the grocery aisle. The Institute of Medicine says it's time to put right up front the most important information for health. How many calories per serving? And just how big that serving is, along with stars or some other symbol to show at a glance how the food rates for certain fats, sodium, and added sugars. American shoppers are busy shoppers. We want a really simple system that says if you have 3 marks, that product is healthier than one with 2 marks.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
The FDA already was working to change the food and labeling system to make it more user-friendly and has promised to crack down on inaccurate labeling that has confused consumers. This is me speaking. I doubt that ever is going to happen. But ranking a food's healthfulness, rather than just providing consumers information to try to judge that for themselves, would mark a major shift in government food policy.
Mm-hmm. Well, the food industry in the United States is the toxic garbage poison food industry.
Yeah, so who's going to make that determination?
Of course, you fools out there that think the FDA, the Food and Drug Administration from the federal government, is on your side, and that everything in a supermarket is approved by the FDA and is healthy for you, you're a sucker. You're a fool. A lemming. You know, it's all bottom line motivated. As profit is their only concern. The same thing with the big signs pushing vaccines in front of Walmart and Walgreens, and you know, telling you, trying to scare you into thinking you need all these vaccines, including the flu vaccine, when you really don't, and they're really not good for you. They're harmful in other ways,
and worthless.
Yeah, it's all from the it's coming from the drug industry, the American pharmaceutical industry, the racket.
Yeah, go up to the Gary Noah website and type in the search of vaccines, and he's got a load of good, accurate, scientific information.
I'll give you one tip, people. A fantastic alternative, a natural, safe alternative for the flu vaccine would be Oxinum by a company called Boiron. It's from France. It's a homeopathic. Capital B-O-I-R-O-N, acylcoxinum. Just type in O-C-C. Don't ask me to spell the whole thing. O-C-C-I.
Acylcoxinum or something.
Something like that. Acylcoxinum. Yeah. It's homeopathic.
It has many.
Yeah.
Many remedies in it.
But I'm sure the Highlands Homeopathic Company, which offers much larger quantities per bottle than Boiron does, I'm sure they have their own cold and flu formula, homeopathic formula. I would go with one of those.
Well, I used to get mine from Beckett's Apothecary in Pennsylvania.
I heard of them. I've heard of them.
I used to get mine all from there.
Yeah. Homeopathy. Well, it's 200 years old. A 200-year-old medical science. It might even have its roots before that.
I think it's around 1847, Heinemann. Heinemann.
He's German?
Oh, yes, of course he is. Absolutely.
Dr. Heinemann.
Like cures like.
And less, don't ask me why this is. Less is more.
Because we're dealing with energy rather than...
Yeah.
Rather than mass.
Like the greater the dilution in homeopathy, the more effective...
The more powerful the remedy is.
Right. Yes. And it's usually, there's usually a number followed by an X or a C. And I believe the C is a greater dilution than the X.
Yeah, it has something to do with 100.
Yeah, like for instance, a very popular homeopathic product for any injury or trauma or post-surgery would be Arnica Montana, which is an extract from a plant called the Mountain Daisy. And the most common Arnica Montana would be 30X.
No, 30C.
I only see X.
X's are usually lower potencies. 6X, 10X, stuff like that. 30C is a powerful remedy that you usually would like take maybe 3 doses or something, watch for improvement or something like that. If you wanted something that would act real quick, you would go for something like 200C.
And then you would take them, it's usually 4 tablets under the tongue, sublingually.
Well, it have to be under the tongue.
Every 4 or 6 hours. Or no, actually until symptoms subside.
Some sort of improvement you see.
It's all symptomatic.
If you don't see any improvement after a while, then you're on the wrong remedy. You have to check the symptoms again and try something
else. Because homeopathy is based on symptoms, not on diagnosed
And it's not something,
illnesses.
And it's not something like regular medicines or something that you would take every day. Except if you're dealing with a constitutional remedy, mm-hmm. maybe. But once there's improvement, you may not need the thing again. If symptoms appear again, then you may need to take it again. But it's not something you would take all the time. Like a regular medication?
No, it's like taking...
Like an antidepressant, you got to take it every day?
It's like taking olive leaf extract. It's only taken when needed. Once the infection subsides,
yeah.
then you stop taking it.
Once the body has, you know, cured yeah. itself, then you don't need it
anymore. Same thing with echinacea or echinacea with golden seal. You do not take it more than a week because it kind of like... The body becomes immune to the effect of the echinacea. Because echinacea, at the beginning, has a very powerful effect on the immune system. It yeah. builds up your immunity, similar to the Asian mushrooms, maitake mushroom,
reishi.
Shiitake, cordyceps, you know. But anyway, we have another good article here.
British naturalist Sir David Attenborough,
I've heard of him,
has spent his career indulging his passion for all life on the planet, writing and narrating natural history programs for BBC broadcasts.
Oh, it's got to be great then.
A modest sampling of subjects, the natural history of Antarctica. The behavior of nocturnal mammals and birds, the mountain gorilla of Rwanda. Now at 85, Attenborough has shifted his focus to a creature that no longer exists, but whose characteristics continue to intrigue scientists. Flying monsters 3D tells the story.
Pterodactyls?
Of a pterosaur. Extinct for hundreds of millions of years.
Is this a form of pterodactyl? A Rodan from the Godzilla movies? Rodan? Not the painter, not the artist.
The film opened this month at the J.D. Williams Science Theater at Liberty Science Center in New Jersey. Excuse me, in Jersey City.
Oh, I've seen that building. It's off of I-95 by Liberty State Park. Where you could view Ellis Island and the Statue of Liberty on Liberty Island. It's very close. And you can also view Lower Manhattan. Because it's right on the Hudson
Wall
River.
Wall Street.
And you could fish. During high tide, you can catch bluefish and striped bass. And yeah, right on the corner. Yep. Little tip.
Pterosaur. Known commonly as... Pterodactyls.
There you go. Terry Pterodactyl from the Pee Wee Herman Playhouse.
Were
puppet.
Flying vertebrates with wingspans of up to 45 feet or almost the width of a 4-lane highway.
I love dinosaurs. I was always a huge Godzilla movie fan and dinosaurs. Yeah, remember Godzilla's
son? That's the sound he made. Godzilla.
Godzilla's son, Minya, he used to go... They gave it like a baby cry.
Yeah.
But anyway, what about your favorite, the captain of the Gorn ship from Star Trek that fought Kirk on
the
planet?
Well, he was a...
He's a Gorn.
Yeah, but he was a cross between a Tyrannosaurus Rex and something else.
He was
else.
Green. He looked like an iguana.
Yeah, but he had the, you know...
He didn't have the big...
John, no. though.
He moved very slowly, but he's very powerfully built, and he says, I shall be merciful.
Yeah, well, you figure it out. Did you look at his hands? How the hell can a person like that, a reptile of that nature, create scientific technology for a starship?
Well, you know, Gene Roddenberry's Star Trek was kind of a low-budget sci-fi series. You know, well, why do all aliens have humanoid form, you know, in other galaxies? Why is everything, you know, have...
That's Wilhelm Reich discovered the orgone, and that's why. Because things grow in only one way.
You know, I mean, there's a big difference between the Klingons and Romulans from the Star Trek series and the modern day ones from the movies. They look more hideous. They look more like aliens in the modern day version. But anyway, yeah,
Wait a minute. They were the approximate size and shape of a modern day giraffe.
They were. A full-grown pterodactyl?
With the 45-foot wingspan.
Oh, wow. They had teeth.
They have teeth.
Were they vegans or were they carnivores?
We're going to learn that. These giant flying monsters, as Attenborough calls them, dominated the skies until their sudden disappearance at the end of the Cretaceous period. They were the biggest flying creatures ever in the history of the Earth. Why they died out and how it came about is what the film is about. The film features 3D and computer-generated imagery technology, which was used extensively in the sci-fi epic Avatar.
Yeah, but you know... The realism of this computer animated 3D imagery has improved enormously. Enormously. I mean, a lot of cartoons are already 2D. And 3D, you know, like, you know, Ralph Cramden's excuse for not buying a television, he's waiting for 3D TV.
South Park is certainly not 3D. It's not even 2D.
No, but some of them...
It's 1D.
Well, that's a low budget.
There is no, they're all flat images.
They're balls.
They're flat.
They're everybody shaped the same.
Yeah.
It's like Beavis and Butthead. Which made a comeback. Another salute to Beavis and Butthead. Thank God you're back, you guys. You two morons.
Oh God.
I saw the new episode 2 weeks in a row, and it cracked me up to no end. Because what they do is they make fun of popular shows today, like Jersey Shore and all of them, and they show the actual scenes from the popular shows, and Beavis and Butthead are tearing them apart, critiquing them and making fun of them. It's really funny. But anyway, continue with the pterodactyl.
Illustrating the story of a flying giant reptile using this technology was a natural fit, Attenborough said. Pterosaurs are marvelously suited to 3D because they move, they fly, they swoop, they glide, and it's thrilling to see the world as they did and to watch as the largest flying creatures the world has ever known come to life in every detail. CGI imaging is sensational in 3D. Obviously, I wanted to exploit that.
Why didn't you tell me my collar was bent the wrong way? Anyway, continue.
Working with fossils and using the guidance of pterosaur experts, the film traces the evolution of the flying creatures, which start off looking like flying lizards with long tails and later become more aerodynamically versatile with short tails. The story is told from a series of places around the world, including China and France. In what is now New Mexico, paleontologists found remains of Quetzalcoatlus.
Quetzalcoatl?
Quetzalcoatlus, touted as the largest animal ever to fly.
You sound like you're one of the. What do they call them? Howard Stern show. The misfits that were on the Howard Stern show. Quetzalcoatl.
Quetzalcoatlus.
It's a god. It's an Aztec or Mayan god, popular god.
That was Quetzalcoatl or something.
Quetzalcoatl.
Yeah, Quetzalcoatl.
What did he call them?
But this is the
Whack Pack. He used to call them the Howard Stern Whack Pack.
This is one of the pterosaurs.
Dirt. Oh, pterosaurs, okay.
That's the biggest animal to ever fly.
Oh, man. Okay?
The Quetzalcoatl.
Yeah, Quetzal my ass.
Pterosaurs and birds share some similarities. They both need to have a mechanism for moving through the air, and they both lay eggs, according to Attenborough.
But are they warm-blooded with bird-like skeletons?
They both also form partnerships.
You know, that is a theory that the dinosaurs might have been warm-blooded like birds, since their bone structure is... They're more closely related to birds than they are to lizards.
Pterosaurs reptiles. Often lived on the colonies on the seacoast on cliffs. The cliff was their launching pad.
Maybe they're fish eaters, like bald eagles.
And we know, for example, that an albatross, which has the biggest wingspan of all living birds, uses the same sort of techniques to keep itself airborne.
You mean it catches the air currents?
Yeah.
If it flies high enough. Well, eagles do that. When you see hawks and eagles hovering, you know, looking down for prey, you know, they ride the wind.
They ride the current, yeah.
Yeah, well, it's smart. Well, conserve energy. They're conserving energy for when they have to swoop down, try to grab something. You know, of course, birds can see the fish from that high up very easily.
Yes, they're very... what's those divers, the ones that...
Eyes of an eagle?
Jump into the water?
Osprey? No, the pelicans? Well, all seabirds really dive into the water after fish. All seabirds do that.
Well, this is a particular one I have in mind, but it escapes me.
And they dive and they swim to the bottom. I think you're thinking of a cormorant? Cormorants.
Has a big long beak and its thin neck. Dives right
storks,
into the water.
Storks, a crane, no. Egrets,
dives right
no.
into... No, they're small. This is a big bird.
Well, there are...
Not the yellow bird on Sesame Street. Big bird. It's a big bird.
Wasn't that a Caribbean song? Yellow bird, very pretty. Anyway, there's a lot of seabirds can dive, hold their breath, and literally, you know...
Find a fish.
Go down... to the bottom of lakes and whatever. Anyway.
An important difference, he points out, is that pterosaurs did not have the muscles of a modern bird or the strength of their wing beats.
Yeah.
They did not have feathers, and their wings were attached quite low down on their bodies. This made it very difficult for them to run on the ground in a nimble kind of way.
Like bats. They can only function in the air. On the ground, they were clumsy.
Attenborough
like
said,
yeah.
The birds with their feathers were able to run around indeed. That may well have been a crucial element to why pterosaurs disappeared. At the end of the film, Attenborough, ever the adventurer, is seen flying in a glider aircraft with a wingspan almost exactly the same size as a pterosaur. To give the viewer an idea of its magnitude. I originally thought I might do that in a hang glider, but unfortunately the insurance wouldn't let me do it. We had to have a helicopter flying alongside the glider, focusing on me while I was talking. Now, the movie, of course, is going to be at the Jersey City Boulevard, Jersey City, the Liberty Science Center.
I'm sure it will make its way to YouTube.
It will be open daily, except on Mondays, and screenings are at 11:30 a.m. and 1:30 p.m. and 3:30 p.m.
Okay.
Screenings on Saturdays and Sundays and holidays. Mm-hmm. It'll cost you $9.
What?
Children 2 to 12, and seniors... And seniors 62 and older, $7.
$9 cover charge?
For kids.
For kids?
For kids, yeah.
To see this documentary?
That's it.
I'll wait till it comes on YouTube. Screw that. What is it, a freaking dance club? I'm anti-cover charge anyway. I think it's a rip-off scam. Anyway, you don't even get a drink with it. But anyway...
Somebody has to make money somewhere, you know.
Yeah, they make money off of donations to a museum, if it's a museum. Or if it's a dance club, they're making money off the booze.
It's not a dance club, it's a Liberty Science
Center. Yeah, science. Well, donations.
Yeah, but they're doing it right with donations and stuff, and public services, the commons. They want you to pay for everything.
Fuck that. You mean like making everything into a privatized business? Everything in this country, they want to make it, they want to implement capitalism into every part of our lives? That's the devil's economics.
Yes, they do.
That's the devil's economics, man.
No kidding, but it's here.
They're greedy, evil. Now, you see how vile. I'm talking to the Reverend Dr. William J. Eisenman, Doctor of Divinity. Do you see how vile the human race really is? Scumbags, naturally born scumbags.
I think that's why they've been cursed for near 6,000 years.
Why do they have to profit from every damn thing? They have to make a profit. Well, if you happen to be a Republican, you want to privatize everything because Republicans are just very greedy, selfish, and stingy people by nature. You know, but why
they never met a dollar they didn't love.
Yeah, but why does it... Well, you know, I'll answer my own question. They want everything to be capitalistic, and they want everything to be privatized, and they want you to pay for your kids' education, and if you're poor, your kid doesn't go to school, and blah, 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 blah. Because, simply, they're that greedy.
Well, it's not that, it's not that holy. It's the fact that they have the power to do so. We have, especially in this country.
Yeah.
Some of the other countries don't go as far as we go. But we in this country have the idea that we're born into this world.
Yeah.
And everything we do by ourselves, and we create our wealth, et cetera, et cetera. We never think, Republicans for certain, they never think in terms of you're born into the world, your mother changes your diaper, your mother feeds you, father takes care of you. For some reason, they believe they've done all these things themselves. All of their lives.
People have given you breaks to get you started in life. Friends of the family, friends of friends, networking, or just, you know, maybe your uncle has an important job. Or, like, in other words, according to Republicans, they think that everybody who has risen to a comfortable standard of living, everybody who is a success, has done it solely on their own merits.
Exactly.
And it's bullshit because people have relied on help from birth until even after adulthood.
Well, you go back in history and you'll see that all communities are communal. They are families, tribes, whatever. They're not an individual. In fact, in those kind of societies, a person who would be an individual would be shunned or frowned upon because he would have, there's a joining together of the community, and he would be outside of that, and he would be looked at as peculiar or queer.
So would you accurately say, before we say goodbye, would you accurately say that throughout human history that human society has always naturally been a progressive, liberal form of society?
Absolutely. We have curiosity. Republicans do not honor curiosity.
I'm talking about the help factor of people helping.
Oh, you don't get anywhere in the primitive societies without the help factor.
The nurturing, the help. And when you become an adult, the community work together
for the benefit of the community.
Or the community, and most people from the olden days were lived on family farms, right?
Exactly.
Family farms. You have the family working the farm.
In fact, who was it? Was it Gary Null or Herbert W. Armstrong? One of them tells a story about their aunt. who had a farm and grew things on the farm and fed the rest of the family. Because the other rest of the family were on hard times.
Yeah.
Now, let's just assume we lived in a primitive society, maybe a couple thousand people or something like that. We had one canoe, and we depended on fish. And this one Jambalone owned this canoe. And he wouldn't share it with the community. He would ask a price so that you could use the canoe. How long would he be in that community?
Throw his ass out.
Exactly.
They say, stick the canoe where the sun don't shine, very deeply.
And he'd be called evil.
Yeah.
And et cetera.
Well, going back to ancient times, people have relied on other people in their families and in their communities. Community sounds like the word commune, doesn't
That's,
it?
Yeah, but it sounds like communism. That's why the Republicans hate it.
Communism. So, socially, the progressive liberal way of thinking not only goes hand in hand with the teachings of the Bible, but it just goes hand in hand with the history of the human race, human society.
Exactly.
So they pull yourself up by the bootstraps. Everybody has to be totally independent and rely on nobody. No one, that Republican conservative propaganda is feeding you, is all that propaganda lies.
In fact, they have new studies which show that certain portions of the brains of liberals and conservatives differ. And liberals
really
have a problem with fear. They fear things.
Maybe
very
that's why
distrustful.
Maybe that's why they want to be liked and accepted by everybody. The one well, drawback.
Liberal, excuse me, I meant conservative.
Oh, I'm sorry. Oh, conservatives are suspicious. And oh, is that why? Is that why somebody I know who is a right-wing conservative says that if an apocalypse ever takes place and we have martial law sets in, he will shoot his neighbors because his neighbors will try to loot his house and take his food and his property and his belongings?
Let's put it this
right?
way.
Instead of thinking, well, people should work together. Yeah. And, you know,
what if I share with them?
Like, maybe, you know, they will share with me, I will share with them, and, you know, when...
And we'll get through this thing together.
And we'll get through this thing together as a community. He wants to blast his neighbors instantly because they're going to loot his house and they want to take what he's got.
Right.
And he votes Republican, by the way.
Exactly. That's why this new study, finding these things... That they require a leader, a Führer.
A Führer, yeah.
Yeah, a daddy. Someone to tell them what to do and how to do it, because they don't have that ability themselves, because they do not like progress, and they do not like getting out of the status quo.
Where the progressive liberal does not require a leader, a dictator, a Führer.
In fact, they work things through with a committee and nobody knows what the fuck they're doing.
Yeah. Well, I'm saying, in other words, right-wing conservatives march in lockstep and they like to follow, they like a leader to spout bullshit at them, and they go, you know, that's why they're like robots and they say the same shit. Tea Party, you know, tax and spend liberal, blah, 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 blah. Welfare cheap.
And they're like the opposite of like the Native Americans' respect for the land was that you can't own the land. The land is the land. The land is God's. The great white father in heaven, whatever.
Yeah.
It's not your land. They never had an idea of property. Private property, but that is very important for conservatives.
Oh, by the way, a conservative, I'm trying to think of who it was in Washington, said that we don't know exactly what's causing global warming, therefore therefore the environmentalists should not even do what they're doing. In other words, we don't know the answer to it, which is bullshit. They know what's causing global warming, right?
Yes. In fact,
there's
a conservative that was against global warming about 2 years ago, and he did a big study and everything, and now he's changed his mind.
Flip-flop. They flip and flop. And,
well, at least he was open to the truth, right?
Well, the
most of them aren't.
Republican candidate, I don't know if it was Rick Perry
Mitt Romney.
What a stupid name.
Mitt and Romney.
Mitt Romney's been flip-flopping.
He's always been flip-flopping.
On the now, he's from Massachusetts. So was the Democrat that shot himself in the foot.
With the helmet.
Yeah.
Riding in the tank.
Yeah. What the hell was he again? He ran against Bush and got creamed.
Yeah.
Oh man, that it'll sucks come, when you can't remember the senator's name.
I can see his picture. I can see his face right before my eyes.
Yeah. He was. Now look, when you flip flop on the issues, it doesn't show a strong backbone.
But yeah, well, you see on that, it shows that you are playing to the group you need their support from.
Yeah.
That's what they do. When they're in Iowa or New Hampshire, they need the religious nuts. So they do the religious nut thing.
Yeah. So, yeah, if you're in the Bible Belt, then you do the religious, everything's about the religious propaganda, the fundamentalism, you know, evangelical, charism, whatever, you know. Oh, anti-abortion, anti-gay,
stem cells,
anti-stem cell research, shove religion and prayer down your kid's throat in school.
Right. Instead of
Racism against people of color.
To cure homosexuality, pray for them. To cure PMS, pray for them.
If you're poor, we'll pray for you.
Pray for you.
Oh, if you're poor and you need welfare, go to your church and get them to support you. That's what Republicans say. Go to your church. Actually, that doesn't work.
Of course it doesn't. It never did work. We tried it already back in the Great Depression. Didn't work. You needed government.
Yeah, what about that bullshit, that Chinese proverb, give a man a fish and he'll eat for one day. Teach a man two fish and he'll eat for a lifetime?
Yeah.
And you told me...
If he's near a river or a lake.
What if he's not near a body of water? Or what if the body of water is...
Polluted.
That's what you told me a long time ago. What if it's polluted? Big deal.
Or what if he's depending on going to the Pathmark or the ShopRite to get his fish?
So...
And by the way, did you see it in the latest news?
Push what?
People who are buying fish and they think they're buying a certain type of fish, they're not buying it.
You mean they're putting a cheap version of something else and charging a higher price?
Yes, exactly.
And is this a particular supermarket?
No, it's all of them.
Is this, oh, really?
All of them.
And remember what I said earlier about deregulation of businesses in the United States? Perfect example. Making you pay top dollar for a certain fish when you're getting a much cheaper fish at a much lower price. It's highway robbery. They're lying. It's false advertising.
They get away with it. They get away with it because we are afraid of them. We are afraid to put the regulations in effect. The laws, the rules.
We have a criminal element running our government. Exactly. Local and national
crime syndicate.
We have
oligarchs.
Oligarchs. They're all. It's a white collar crime mentality, like Bernard Madoff. They're actually permitted to lie to you, the consumer, and sell you crap at a higher price in disguise of something else. It's like taking chop steak and trying to sell it to you for the price of filet mignon or black Angus ribeye or something like that, of that nature. It's insane. Anyway, thank you for joining us for Progressive Discussions, I believe, number 92. We'll see you next time. Say so long.
Hasta la vista. And God bless.
Didn't Tiny Tim say that on A Christmas Carol? God bless us all, everyone.
Yes, he did.
That annoyed the shit out of me.
He actually should have hit Scrooge on the head with his crutch.
Ebenezer Scrooge? Yeah, he should have whacked him hard. Motherfucker.